Futures and options on futures trading involve substantial risk and is not a suitable investment for all types of investors. Past results are not necessarily indicative of future results. When I use the word I in this video, it refers to what I teach in my charting course or what I offer in my twice daily oral and written updates. Prices shown on charts and quote boards are in real time and take into account all known activity up to this point in time. And if you'd like to read more of this disclaimer, simply hit the pause key on your video player. Good afternoon. Ira Epstein with your agriculture update for this Wednesday, and we're at the 25th of May, 2017, just getting on to 2 p.m. Central Daylight Time. And as you can see, the corn and the wheat market down, and it's interesting where the corn stopped. When I show you the Bollinger Band tops, you'll see what's going on there. Sugar market running into some key resistance. And there's a common theme that seems to be going between sugar, wheat, corn. They're spinning around inside of ever-tightening, what we'll call the Bollinger Bands, narrowing in. And when that happens, you have to think of compressing prices to a point where eventually they break out, and that's the goal, trying to catch which way that's going to be and hoping it turns into a trend. We can see today that the stock market's all in red for a change, and I use the word for a change. Earnings weren't that good from a couple of companies that came out. Chipotle led the way on that. Dollar index slightly lower as the market is waiting to see what the European Central Bank does. Canada came out today, and the Canadian government, their bank, basically said they're going to sit tight for a bit. I think NAFTA's on everybody's mind. What does it mean? Not that much inflation, and away you go. We also haven't heard anything when you go to the soy complex yet from the Commerce Department on whether they're going to put tariffs on Argentina or not, but I have to think the market's already built it in the biodiesel, assuming the worst case scenario. When we take a look at soybeans on a weekly, and this is your weekly area chart of closes, you still haven't closed under a previous settlement low. See that right through here? So the overall pattern is you had a break low, then you made higher closes, closing lows, and higher high closes. I'll call that an upthrust on the market. The downthrust happened here on the daily chart as you're leaking away and you get these little bumps and they don't do anything in the market. Obviously, the big number to wonder about is the low 970s. Can the market even get down there? I say that because when you go to a daily bar chart, you have a market that at first I thought we were going to have a flag, if you will, the market waving in the breeze and going up. But this break has gone a little bit too far for me to consider that as a possible formation. And that's the other thing. Whenever you look at charts, for those of you that are chartists, and there's a number of you, the hardest thing to do is chart formations. I know you'll all tell me it's easy. Unfortunately, I got four decades of doing it. One day it's a pennant. I can draw down there to over here. Next day it's a flag. Next day it's a dog in the sky. I mean, that's the problem. I like to use a different set of indicators that do it for me, and I can look. And all I can see on this chart right now is that I got a pattern of lower highs, lower lows. I believe that is the definition of a trend. Now, you do filter trends. You're always looking to put as much reasonable filters as you can on a trade, trying to, number one, catch a trend with it. Number two, your rules as to where risk rewards come in and why you're making the trade. One of them that I use is the 18-day average of closes. I think it's, and I've called it so often for you, the line in the sand. When the market is over it, bullish bias. Under it, bearish bias. If the market's way up and it slips down, it is not uncommon that the market goes to that number and fights a battle to see what it's going to do next. I think that's exactly what you've got here. You have a downtrend, but you haven't turned the bias down. If the market can clear this 983 and a quarter area, well, maybe it gets down to the 100-day average just the same way it did here. It doesn't mean you fall apart. That's just the next support zone in the market. But being under the 18-day average would give you two things. You would have the trend already down, bias down. The market stopped at the upper Bollinger Band. I guess if you took out this break low back here, you could argue that the lower Bollinger Band might come in play. But the first number in play should be the 100-day average if the market breaks down. And momentum is still saying, prices are what? If you believe that momentum leads price, it is still in the bear camp. It's still pointing to the downside. When we come to the meal market, here's a great example of what I'm saying. If we take a look, here is the market in a downtrend, and it closes under the 18-day average. So at this point, you have a couple of things. You have the trend down as defined by the swing line. You're under the 18-day average of closes, so the possible next support zone is the 100-day average. If that gives ground, 308, the momentum is down. The market yesterday falls to that 100-day average. If it rallies back up, I'm going to look for potential resistance at 318.10. If that's hit, then you reactivate the support at 313.30. I'll also keep my eye on the fact that this market is now oversold. Any reading under 30 is oversold. This is today's action. You rally right back up. Challenge didn't quite get to that 18-day average and you're remaining oversold. So I'd be a bit cautious about this market. You know, I took flight for a long time. I became a pilot. And one of the things I didn't like about flying was landing. I hated it. Okay? I love flying. I hated landing. But what I did learn as I was going for my license and everything was what? I learned that you have a checklist before you ever take off. Getting up in the sky and then deciding to say, oh, I forgot to check my valves or something else on the plane, my wheels. It could be 100 things. No, that's not what you do. Well, it's like a trade. If one part of your checklist isn't working, what's the importance of that part? And that's what you have to make decisions on. It's what I always do. And that doesn't mean that I have winning trades. I have my own share of losing recommendations that I put out for my subscribers, but I have winners too. When you look at the daily bar chart on soybean oil, now you've got what I'm going to call distribution taking place up here. You have a situation where the slow stochastics, which are these two numbers, it's made up of two numbers that move around each other. George Lane called them a K and a D line. He was the man that developed this. Both numbers are over 80 here. The day before, they're both under 80. The day before, which is Monday, they're both over 80. So through the close today, you have 3 days in a row where they're over 80, so that's embedded. Normally, I'd say that means the market's going to find support on breaks. But when you get an outside day down under a previous low, it creates a problem. I would not be surprised that the market loses that reading by getting on the opener tonight, assuming the market just opens steady, that number slips under 80. So it'd be interesting to see what happens. Support's back at 33.81 to 49. So I'm questioning if this market's not ready to convert from locking in an uptrend to becoming overbought instantly. In the corn market, this is classic and something important that's developed. First off, let's go to yesterday's close. I mentioned to you, look at all this tight sideways action. Remember, this top black band and the bottom are part of that Bollinger Band theory, in which the market as it trades will stay within these bands 95% of the time. The problem is eventually you leave sideways action for another price tier, be it up or down. And the longer you get the sideways action, the stronger the eventual move when it breaks out. I didn't say which way it's breaking out. What I'm saying is the stronger move. Now there's another step to this. If you'll notice, we haven't hit the upper Bollinger Band in months, since literally the beginning of the summer. I think you got to go way back here. I'm not even sure myself. It doesn't matter. The fact is, and I've mentioned, when we hit the upper band, it's sort of a warning sign that something in the market is trying to make a change. Doesn't mean it has changed. It's trying. And guess what? You hit the upper band today, and you pulled right back off of that. So I think this market, number one, is still coiling for a move. The market is, or was, let me put the right grammar on it, overbought yesterday, got up to the upper Bollinger Band. I think the pros stepped out of the market there. I think support's back at the 18-day average. But now I've got my antenna up. As I'm looking at this market, could we be getting to a point where this market wants to start lifting potentially to the upside? I don't know. In the wheat market, we have a lower low, a higher high. It wasn't strong enough to get to the upper Bollinger Band. It's just sort of failing and sitting at that line in the sand with, again, this fabulous sideways action. The sugar market doing the same as those other markets. Look at how this market's narrowing in. Momentum is up. You came today up to a high of 14.37, so I really have this arrow in the wrong place. It should be now because it's we took out 1435, I should move that arrow and have it point up. Sometimes I like to leave intentional things like that to teach you. In my charting course, you really learn most of this. The way you're going to learn it here is not going to be replacing the course. I do that intentionally. All right, in the coffee, momentum down. This market could easily be for another leg to the downside. Now, why am I saying that? Well, first of all, you're not trending, I do agree, because you got a higher high and a lower low. But if we look at the stochastics, both numbers today under 80, yesterday both were under 80. Tomorrow's going to be a key day. If you embed, and unlike what we saw in soybean oil, if you embed off sideways action, that could be even more bearish. So you got to keep your eye on that. Assuming you take out yesterday's low, look for support at the lower Bollinger Band. If you rally, I'd see resistance at the 18-day average on this pattern, and I would definitely be looking at the slow stochastic. Generally, you don't embed, so the odds favor this market's going to try to rally. If it doesn't, another story. How many times have I told you about this crazy cocoa market that it keeps going back to this 18-day average, finding support there for whatever reason and going back to the upper Bollinger Band? Eventually, it's not going to work. It's been working that way since right here. You look at how many of those have occurred. A lot of them occurred in overbought conditions. You're not overbought. Momentum's pointing down, and now the market closed under the 18-day average. That may not be the pattern. You got to look tomorrow. But if you take out today's highs, I think you're going to attract on the rally the bulls back to the market. I wonder today if they're questioning the idea. In the cotton, you're right into a key resistance area. Not a trend area, a key resistance area. You're up to the 100-day average and the upper Bollinger Band and getting thrown back. Momentum-wise, when you reopen, you could easily be in overbought territory as that red line's climbing each day just a little bit until the market offers more of a break. On a break, first support 69.11, the 100-day average, and under at 68.32. Again, we're not trending. In the cattle market, you hit the upper Bollinger Band yesterday, today, you're backing off from it in an overbought condition. Support's back towards that 18-day average at the 116.80 level. In the feeder cattle, you're right up to your resistance point. The upper Bollinger Band seems to be running out of upside momentum. Unlike the fat cattle, you have a lower low and a higher high. So I'll call it no trend, and it's overbought. Yes, I'm the first one to know the market's making new highs. So that doesn't mean that you have to have what we call a trend in place as defined by the pattern of higher highs, higher and lows, or lower highs, lower lows. Often you get patterns that have an opposite, a higher high and a lower low. In the hog market, the market is overbought. It's the first thing my eye goes to. It is in an uptrend. It's got upside bias. It loses that if yesterday's low is taken out at 62.95. So I'd be cautious with that. So in looking at all the markets today, interesting day. Again, the stock market down, but there's no real volatility on the downside. So a lot of cautions being thrown out. Gold tried the rally. First, it tried the break real hard, came back. We'll see what that all does for the market. As you know, I write like a madman, and I do a lot of research you don't find elsewhere. Sometimes I do a synopsis of events that you can see in other areas. Other times I'm talking to research people you don't get your hands on. But what I do that you don't get to see is, if, unless you're a subscriber or have a free trial to my research as a person that just came in for the trial, you don't get to see this morning all-important update. And that is how I set you off. I have a cup of coffee, I swear to you, sitting right in front of me. I sit back and I start recording 40 charts. I'm not in the video, I'm talking. I've got a whole professional setup, and you'll find the sound quality great. And I'm giving you in and out trade ideas, what I think the pros will do. It's not what I write about. This is telling you 40 years of what I'm seeing. So as a way to start your day, I'm trying to set you up with what I'm seeing, and maybe that triggers what you were seeing yourself. If you haven't tried it, it is something that I think you should try. Then what I do is I give you the write-ups during the day, and I'm giving you a synopsis of the day's events and news, and often I'm leading you into an area that you may not even be aware of with my own research and people that I'm talking to throughout the day. Yes, I will offer specific trade recommendations here, but there's a lot more in that video than I write about. So what I do is I put out a daily video. You get my written trade recommendations, often 2 to 3 a day, often. 2 for certain Monday through Thursday, 1 on Friday in the morning, sometimes more, and it's certainly Sunday night to get your trading off. And then if you like the oral update where you want to hear me talk for a few minutes about what I'm seeing, I put that out as well. Remember, you can say a lot more on a phone than you can write about. It'd be too lengthy. How do you get this? If you haven't tried it, give us a call at this number. Go to our website. You can click up here at any time if you're watching me on YouTube or under us on many websites that says click here for Ira's free information. I'm Ira Epstein. You have a great day, and I'll see you all.